All right, next up, Allison Vogelsong is going to be talking about what kind of data is inside Harmony.
Hi, my name is Allison Vogelsong. I'm the 2016-2017 Michigan Sea Grant Fellow at the International Joint Commission. And today, broadly, we're going to be talking about data for science communication. But I'll actually be giving examples from my personal account, as well as a few examples from the IJC account, to more specifically dive into data that can inform your audience before you start messaging. So today we're going to start with a framework for your SciComm or science communication. And from there, we're going to define what is an audience, since that's a question I think so far has been unanswered today. Then we're going to understand some principles of social network analysis, and we'll use those to evaluate tools that are available for social media data analysis, as well as do a little bit of social network analysis ourselves. And we'll do that in order to use this data to inform our audience selection for our science communication. So just like your science communication needs a framework. I recommend the Compass message box, which is developed specifically for science communicators. It has six steps, and the first step is to identify your audience. And today we are not going to pass go or collect $200 or do anything else until we identify our audience and make that an informed decision. So lesson number one today is that there is no general public audience. You can write that down, it's very important. Why? Because it doesn't exist, because it's not an audience. So what is an audience? It's a well-defined segment, sure, that you can include people in, but it's one that you can also exclude people from. So it will create a very specific boundary for you that you can help identify. You can use this audience Mad Libs to help conceptualize what I mean by a specific audience. So you've got noun, verb, location. For example, scientists attending IAGO 2017. It's specific because it excludes scientists not attending IAGO 2017. Or perhaps like me, non-scientists attending 2017 at And we're not just going to pull our audience out of a hat and hope that our science communication reaches this audience. And that's what we'll do today, is use different data tools to identify who's our current audience that we are engaging with, or who's potential new audiences that we can engage with through. And one thing that's been reiterated today is that we all have a different science communication goal. Perhaps it's action or funding, but it's going to be some type of engagement or participation from your audience. And since social media is a communication platform, we can use a measure of the direction of the flow of communication to help us measure participation. It can be one-way flow of communication, shouting into the internet, or it can be a two-way communication or participation. And that's what gets us to social network analysis. It's a method that measures the linkages between people as well as shows the structure of those linkages. So you can think, you know, Kevin Bacon, 6 degrees of separation, but it's not exactly that. It's actually more like this very oversimplified map of you, me, and Bob. And social network analysis is a systems approach. It can measure many things, but most often it measures directionality between units. It can measure that for communication flows, for example, as well as the strength of the ties between units. It can also measure your network for its strength, of its reach, or its structure. And it can also collect information about the attributes of the people in the network. So we're going to use social and network analysis principles to evaluate non-social network analysis tools. And we can use these four principles of directionality, strength, reach, and attributes in order to ask, is this data helpful for identifying our audience? Who am I engaging? That's what directionality will tell us. Who am I engaging more or less? You want to know the answer, then the strength of those relationships will help you to learn that. Who else can I engage out there? That's what the reach of your network will help inform you. And what about these people should I know? Or the information that the attributes can help to provide. So we can provide this evaluation framework, and we can look at existing tools such as Twitter Analytics. Twitter Analytics has these engagement tools and engagement statistics that have been used in different presentations today. And they look pretty good, and you can parse them out, but when you look at these numbers like engagements, it's actually measuring too many different relations all in one. So when it says engagements, it's conflating clicks, retweets, replies, likes, and follows all into one statistic. And that brings us to our second lesson today, which is that this data is not a popularity contest, and social media engagement is not a popularity contest. And that's why social network criteria is very helpful, because it helps us get you the good data and overlook or not spend too much time obsessing about the popularity contest type data. So we're going to apply these four criteria to some example tools, and there's so many tools out there, I can't possibly go through all of them for you, and what we'll do today is give you the tools for yourself, this checklist that you can go through, and if you're considering using a tool to identify your audience, these four criteria can help you determine if the tool is helpful in informing your audience. So, Communit or Communenty is a tool that fulfills all four criteria. And a warning is that it's free, but it's freemium, and your inbox will fill with sales pitch spam emails, so you've been warned. But it's a very helpful tool. And the context here is that I created a brand new account about a month ago. It's got 20 followers, I think. And I did this to prove that a tool that fulfills all four criteria will be helpful for identifying your audience, even if you don't have an audience or you don't have a lot of followers. You don't need to have an established social media presence for a good tool to be helpful. So with Communenty, all four of these criteria apply. It can tell us about the directionality of the relationships. So Nicole's SciComm Monday account, it's told me I'm engaged with them on Twitter. And it says that I'm engaged because even though we weren't following each other's accounts at the time, so it's a popularity statistic, right? We had mentioned each other in the content of our tweets. We were having a conversation. So it's a two-way direction relationship. And by Communenty's metrics, that means that we're engaged. It also tells us about the strength of our relationship. For example, at the time I made the screenshot, we had mentioned each other twice. I'm sure by now that strength is much higher. And it also tells me about the attributes of SciComm Monday. For example, as an engaged follower, I might be interested to know that she likes to talk about SciComm or Periscope, the live video broadcasting tool. We'll take another example of the IJC's Twitter account, and it says that they're engaged with the Great Lakes Commission. And I'm using this to show you that it measures different relationships separately. So it's giving me different statistics about mentions versus retweets. And it's also giving me information about a one-way relationship. For example, in the time frame that it measured, at this particular time, IJC had favorited Great Lakes Commission tweets, but the Great Lakes Commission had not favorited IJC tweets. So it's a one-direction relationship, and this tool can tell you that. And finally, when it comes to reach, Communenty or Communit does suggest other followers that you can engage. You don't necessarily have to be following each other. It just tells you based on not the number of followers, but your engagements, and you can click on those, and it can tell you what kind of engagements are you having with these accounts, even if they're not following you, you're not following them. And this is a great way to start looking at the two Kevin Bacons away from yourself in terms of where the reach of your network has potential to grow. And so why does this matter? It's that it gives us more information to develop a specific informed audience. So whereas before I wanted to communicate with SciComm advocates, now that I know that my account is engaged with users like Nicole, I can say Twitter is the right platform to reach them, and maybe I want to narrow it down and talk to video-based science communicators. And I'm going to show you an example of a tool that does not fulfill all four criteria. Now, Twitter counter seems like a nice graph, and right here it's plotting a number of tweets per day from the IJC's Twitter account and the total number of followers. And on this particular day, it says we tweeted 13 times, and I'm not doing the tweets, you can't take any credit for that, and that we gained 6 followers. So it seems like a nice graph, but it doesn't give us directionality, strength, reach, attributes, and it abstracts the data from the context. So the International Joint Commission had 6 public meetings in March. And on this particular day, we had a packed the Lake Erie Center in Toledo. The mayor was standing in the hallway. There was no room. But this data doesn't tell us anything about if the followers we gained that day had anything to do with Toledo or Lake Erie or had sort of the topics we were talking about and if we were engaging the people in that room. It's just a little misleading in telling us about our audience. And that brings me to my third lesson for today, which is definitely been reiterated already in the other sessions, which is that social media is people. And so popularity measures don't give you meaning when you're looking to use data to identify who your audience is, because they're not telling you anything about the people behind the Two Yellow Louise account, for example. And that's why social network analysis can give us these four principles, and it's good because it's measuring the relationships between people. But it also can be a good tool itself. And so what I'll do is I'm going to do a live demonstration of a tool called Netlytic, which is in the spirit of binationality in Canada, Ryerson. And Netlytic is a social network analysis tool. It can measure Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, or data sets that you upload. So it has wide functionality. And today I'm just going to look at Twitter, and I've plugged in my personal account with 20 followers, again, because it fulfills those four criteria, so it's really not going to miss anything important. So there's two different kinds of networks that Netlytic can map. One's called a name network, and one's called a chain network. And so I'm going to use hashtag social Great Lakes, and I'm going to map a name network. And what that means is it's going to map people who tweet about social Great Lakes and then mention other accounts in their tweets. And it's going to show me the relationships between those accounts. And if you've been tweeting today, you're going to show up on this map somewhere. And even between when I stood up for the presentation and right now, 52 posts have contributed to the conversation. But in time, I'm not going to add them to the list. So we've got this really cool map. I'm going to make the layout that's a little bit more intuitive. So, name network. Oh, you can't see it. Jeez. Network that I'm connected to. and I've got these people who would be in my network. So what you can do with this, which is great, is you can start to see who's maybe 2 Kevin Bacon or 3 Kevin Bacon, right, degrees away from you. They're called WOFs in social network analysis. So, hey, I mentioned the Late Guardian. So here's the people who Late Guardian are talking about or talking to. Or, for example, if I'm saying, okay, well, here's what Katie and I are talking about. Here's all the people, again, who Katie are talking about. So these are people who are that next layer out. You can get 2, 3, 4, as far out as the total diameter or width of your network is. And as we can see, to get from one color cluster to another color cluster is about 7 Kevin Bacon degrees of separation. So it's getting bigger. When I was doing this for my colleagues the other day, it only had a diameter of about 5. So that's one network. And the other kind of network is called a chain network. And I'm going to use a different data set, and that's looking at Twitter users using hashtag iAdler2017. But this network is measuring a different relationship. And that relationship are replies, which for people who aren't familiar with Twitter, it's a different function. You actually have to click a button to reply to and have more of a one-on-one conversation with a person on Twitter. And again, since I started this talk, 42 conversations have happened. And as you can see, it's a much smaller map with a lot less noise going on. Why? Because you're not getting the noise of just retweets or kind of the extraneous conversations that you might not consider engagement or participation. You're getting actual conversations. And as you can see, our friend over in the UK is not at the conference and has a lot of time to talk with people. And you're getting all of these different networks. So here's Solomon. Here's the people who he's been replying to. And they're replying to his tweets a lot more than he's replying to theirs because the numbers are what show me that. And so this is just telling me where the conversations are happening. And again, what I can learn from this is that here's the people who are talking about the same things that I'm talking about. They're using similar hashtags, but maybe I'm not talking to them yet. And I can use this information to identify them as potential new audiences that I want to reach out to and start engaging with. And why do I want to connect with these people? Because they're more likely to connect back and have meaningful conversation or have participation with me. So finally, on Netlytic, if you don't want the time suck of playing with the maps because they're really fun and an hour or 2 hours will go by before you know it, you can look at these reports. And so these reports sort of give you just top information. You can see for IAGLA 2017, tweets have just skyrocketed since the conference started compared to before. You can see who are the posters who are talking the most just in general. And so people who are in the SciComm session make up the lion's share of those tweeters. You can see other terms that people are using when they're using hashtag iAdler2017, as well as their who are the most popular accounts that are being talked about on Twitter. And so what do we take away from this? Is that the people in this room are the ones doing the most tweeting. And so if we've identified our audience as scientists attending iAdler 2017, we need to dig deeper to see which scientists are those. And is that the right Twitter, or is Twitter the right platform to be reaching them? And again, with Netlytic, you can analyze your Instagram and see if maybe those scientists you're trying to reach are maybe on there or another platform. Back to PowerPoint. Hopefully it will work now. So one super quick example, when I was on Nicole's SciComm Monday, we were talking about SciComm. So this is a map of us talking on SciComm Monday, pretty much just to each other. It's a map of the 24 hours, other Twitter users using hashtag SciComm Monday. So here's the rest of the world talking about SciComm, and we're just a very small corner. One thing that sticks out right here, these were people talking about the science march in Missouri, of all places. And so what you can learn, and what I see from this map, for example, is that Twitter is a world of possibility if you want to connect with other science communicators, and you can start playing with and learning about the other people in this network to see, are they an audience you want to engage with? What else are they talking about when they're talking about science communication? So you can use Netlytic to talk about Salmonoid populations, and you can see who else on Twitter perhaps is talking about that. Super fast, one last example. Not all science communication happens online. The IJC had 6 events throughout the Great Lakes Basin in March, and we engaged with more than 700 people. We had some surveys, and so I used some social network analysis mapping to map the responses of these surveys. And so as you can see, when we asked people, for example, what event were you at? They said, this one. And people didn't attend more than one event, so it seems like we had these very disconnected clusters. But if we ask them and we do a two-mode network analysis, as it's called, to connect what event they were with what organization they're associated with, we can see that groups like Sierra Club or Lions for the Great Lakes are becoming these connectors in a network. So people who are affiliated with those organizations sent their members to more than one event. And we can see that, for example, Detroit and Sarnia both had Sierra Club members attending. And so not only did we learn the three lessons today and the four criteria for evaluating any tool, you can pick any data analysis tool for social media that you want for these four criteria, and you can start to plug in the information you get there into your audience Mad Libs. So the IJC, for example, learned that Sierra Club members who volunteer in and around Lake St. Clair were an audience we were engaging with and maybe one we want to engage with more. And now you're allowed to plug in your informed audience selection to your framework of your messaging tool, and you can start going out, having conversations, and not just shouting into the inner tubes, hoping someone will respond, but that you can start having conversations about your science. Thank you. And over time, I don't know if I have questions. Nicole's saying maybe one question.
Yeah, go ahead real quick.
Okay.
Oh, I'm curious, does this work for other things like Facebook? Because I assume LinkedIn is similar to something that they use.
Yeah, so the Netlytic one I was demoing has Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, and then you can upload data sets, and the social media lab through Ryerson, I'm sure, would be interested in looking into other tools, but you can use, even if you're looking at LinkedIn as a tool itself, you can use your four criteria to see if LinkedIn is going to be helpful in identifying, is that a good platform, or what kind of audience.